Ross, who penned this essay, was also the guest editor of the volume Best Music Writing 2011, in which he included a blog post by concert pianist Jeremy Denk, who writes a blog called Think Denk. Denk wrote this particular post, which is titled Jet Lag Manifesto, while having random thoughts at 4 in the morning after traveling on one of his concert tours. Denk lambasts in this particular post stodgy program notes for classical music concerts. And here are some of those random thoughts and what he eventually had to say about them. Yes. Sometimes performances bring pieces to life, but sometimes we kill them instead. Performers, and this seems obvious, inevitable, we're human, we're all culpable, are sometimes complicit in the death of classical music. If the concert is sometimes a murder of what should be a living work, program notes are the chloroform rag we use to numb the victim, and if you're dragging into the scene of the crime. Ha! Yes, I realize it's unfair to carp about program notes at 4 a.m. just because you're grumpy about being awake and stressed about practicing Ligeti etudes, but this program note thing had been on my mind for a while. It seems regrettable that a writing style called program note style ever came into existence. It's hard to define, I suppose. You know it when you read it, by a slight heartburn of the soul. When I start to compose program notes, I feel the siren of this style calling me. The words clump into cliché paragraphs, habits learned from hundreds of programs perused in waiting moments. You begin with a few dates, then you slip in the curious historical tidbit, while he composed X in 18XX, curiously, he didn't publish it until 18XX. The tidbit that makes it seem authoritative, knowledgeable, yawn, yawn, ah, select all, delete, contemplate blank screen with relief. Denk then goes on to enumerate what he calls the deadly sins of program notes, namely historicization, making them generic, sort of using insiders club terminology, and domestication. He gives a witty example under insiders club program notes writing, which I'll read for you right now. Sin number 3, insiders club. Included in many program notes are tidbits of historical information. It's amazing how canonical these tidbits can be. I played Beethoven's first concerto a number of times last season, and every single program noted that while the first concerto was called number 1, it was actually composed second after the second concerto, which was actually first. Now, as a performer in person, I'm theoretically glad I know this in the larger context of the Beethoven story. But finally, yawn. In fact, double yawn. Yawn times infinity plus 1. Suppose you as a listener and program note reader do not know the second concerto, and you're just looking for help to appreciate the work before you. This seems like a pretty meta piece of information to help you out. It seems like what a kind of tedious museum guide would say. Ironic, because of all Beethoven works, the first concerto is not meta. From the moment the piano enters, its simplicity requires no insider information. Beethoven takes care to speak to you with obvious grammar, with clear rhetoric, almost phrasing for dummies, and he takes you dummies through an epic tale nonetheless, using the harmonic equivalent of C, Jane, Run as a doorway to shaded, subtle corners of tonality. When I find these tidbits in program notes, I get an unshakable mental image. A group of gentlemen in smoking jackets, smoking cigars in a private club, exchanging, I say, old chap, did you know that the first concerto was actually composed second? They're chortling to each other, but their back is to you. Through the knowledge they share, they exclude the larger group. The tidbits of knowledge are a badge of belonging, even though they do not particularly or centrally illuminate the work in question. For some reason, these tidbits have become a habit, even a required element of program notes. I have no idea why. And finally, classical music has become a mainstay on all types of social media, including Twitter, which is home to the annual Opera Club contest. Entrants in that contest have the daunting challenge of boiling down opera plots, which always have inordinate numbers of twists and turns, into 140 characters. In 2010, the contest judge of the Twitter Opera Plot Contest was the phenomenal German tenor Jonas Kaufmann. I thought I'd read some of the 2010 winning Opera Plot Twitter Contest entries, all of which are included in this volume, by the way, Best Music Writing 2011. So we'll hear first, these are obviously very brief, so by way of wrapping up. We'll hear first the winning entry by Daniel John Kelly of New York City, who wrote this tweet, actually, to summarize the plot of Tchaikovsky's opera Eugene Onegin. So I wrote this guy this epic love letter, and he's like, no thanks, but now I'm married and rich, and he's all, OMG, I love you. WTF. James Harrington wrote this tweet, boiling down, summarizing the opera plot of Andrea Shenge. James Harrington took notes from Tennessee. Idealistic poets take note. Apparently, I wish to end economic injustice. Sounds a lot like, just go ahead and kill me, in French. And last but not least, yes, okay. This is Sam Newman of New York City. He wrote this opera plot named Tweet to summarize the plot of Verdi's La Traviata. Father is less than enthusiastic about son's love affair with aging, bankrupt, terminally ill prostitute. Can you believe it?